Hi, welcome back. I'm Chris Hitchens, your college admissions coach, member of the Bethel Park Chamber of Commerce. In this segment, we're going to talk a little bit about the admissions scandal going on in the news right now. We're going to talk about IEPs in college, and we're going to talk about the processes to follow at home to work your student through the college application process and the college planning process. First, the scandal. What's going on with the scandal? I think most people, everyone's informed, but a lot of people don't. Some people may not understand what's happening with the scandal with celebrities like Felicity Huffman and Lori Loughlin bribing SAT coaches, having people take the SAT for their student, having proctors change scores on the SATs for their children, and also bribing college coaches. Now, how does bribing college coaches help your student get into college? Well, these students weren't even athletes, so they were saying they were athletes on the rowing team or the crew team. And there are, or there can be, lower admission standards for athletes. So the crew team at the University of Southern California has a certain admission standard, and most of the members of the crew team have to follow that regular standard like every other student. A small number of students can be a little bit below that standard. Not a lot, but a few can be a little bit below that that admission standard GPA SAT score. And then a few more can be even a little lower on that standard. So yes, there's something called dual enrollment for athletes at a lot of colleges, where a small number of them don't have to meet the regular admission standard. This is actually good news for a lot of athletes in Western Pennsylvania. So if you're looking to play sports, maybe at a smaller college, Division II, Division III, and your grades are very high, coaches will definitely look at that favorably. And it's possible to earn a spot on a team for high grades. Even if you're not going to be the star or even a starter, they need to keep their grade point average up for their squad. So it's a little bit of a benefit. All right, so what's going to happen to these people? Well, right now, there's about 50 people going to be indicted right now. That's parents only, not counting the colleges. I'm sure there's going to be a lot more people involved in the college end. So people are losing their jobs, just like these two actresses. Their kids are getting, if they're in college right now, there's a good chance they won't be returning to that college. I'm sure there's going to be a number of fines, and there might be jail time. All right, so this is all... A lot of this is based on the SAT. We're going to talk about the SAT. So people feel that maybe the SAT is racist or the SAT is elitist, and they are probably correct. The SAT right now is the greatest indicator, most consistent indicator of how the child, how the student will do in college, how successful they'll be in college. It's also the greatest indicator of a parent's wealth, how affluent they are. Why? Well, a lot of it's based on what school they go to. So every school district is different. And the education you get at one school district in Western Pennsylvania can be vastly and is vastly different from another school district just a few miles down the road. So is that fair? Probably not, because how are schools funded? They're funded through local real estate taxes, the houses, the homes in that district. And so more affluent school districts have more money to spend. So is that fair? So that's kind of where the unfairness, that's one branch of where things aren't necessarily fair to the students. So if you take AP English at one school district, that AP English grade at one school district does not equate to an AP English grade at another school district. So what do colleges do? They look for the SAT to sort of level that comparison field. So this student has a 4.0 at this school district, this student has a 4.0 at this other school district. Well, GPA-wise, they look equal, but every school district is not the same. So we work with the SAT. The SAT is supposed to level the comparison field. And so one school district, student has a 4.0, but they don't have a great SAT score as another student at another school district who also had a 4.0 grade point average. So that's the beginning of the SAT. Unfairness. The SATs, where do they begin? Well, the colleges in the United States all developed from not long after the Revolutionary War, from the Protestant churches, and they all developed and formed their different colleges, and that was the formation of the Ivy League schools, and that's why they're all over here on the East Coast. So the Ivy League schools eventually had to determine who's going to get in, and so they came up with the SAT, which originally was called the Scholastic Aptitude Test. And then some people got mad about that, and then it was called the Scholastic Achievement Test, and some people got mad about that, feeling that maybe some people were offended. And now the SAT doesn't stand for anything. So that's a great quiz question you can use at dinner tonight. The SAT doesn't stand for anything, so SAT, it's not an acronym. It's just the name of the test. Anyway, so they want to determine, actually used it not for only who gets in, but who to keep out. So who would they want to keep out? Sometimes different schools wanted to keep out Catholics, people who were Jewish. They wanted to keep out minorities. They wanted to keep out immigrants. They wanted to keep out people who were in a lower caste system, lower class that they felt. And that's what the SATs are used for. Now, the SATs are supposed to level the playing field. And I'm not convinced that they do that at this point. College admissions are very tricky. Colleges just don't go by GPA and SAT score. They look at the whole student. They're trying to build a community. The Supreme Court just decided that the colleges can use race as part of their entrance decision-making process. So why is there a discrepancy in SAT scores? SAT scores are based on, a lot of the SAT is based on, honestly, how much the student reads. So if you can have your student reading at an early age, reading a lot, early childhood, read to the student, talk to the student, have conversations. This is what builds vocabulary. And this is one thing that really, in the long run, is going to boost your SAT scores. So there are so many things that are going to be unfair, and it's very difficult to level the playing field. We come back in our next segment after we talk to Heather Campbell from Clumsy Tutoring. We're going to talk about the processes parents can go through to find that great school. They don't have to resort to bribery that always usually ends in a mess for both the parents, the students, and the college. But to find that best school, you don't have to pay anybody off. There's a process. And we're going to look beyond our local schools and kind of open up that playing field. We're going to be right back with Heather Campbell from Club Z.
Hey, it's Christine from Bethel Park Library. I want to tell you about a great fundraiser we have going on. You can take home a print of this cute sloth painted by local artist Maria Prasik, was inspired by Vivian, the sloth that lives at the National Aviary. The original painting will be housed at the Bethel Park Library forevermore, but you can own a 16 by 20 print for $50. You can purchase it at the Bethel Park Public Library or through the library's website at bethelparklibrary.org.
Welcome back. I'm Chris Hitchens, your college application coach, member of the Bethel Park Chamber of Commerce. And again, joining us is Heather Campbell from Club Z Tutoring. Hi, Heather.
Hi, Chris.
Welcome back.
Good to be back.
You're here. That's why you're back pretty much in every every show. So
I enjoy being here. Thanks for having me again.
No problem. All right. What are we going to talk about today?
So I think that we're going to continue on the theme from last month.
Yes.
Is transitioning from high school to college, when you have an IEP or a 504 plan in place, I know you kind of get those questions, and I get them too, so I thought it was good to get more information on that and come back here today with that information.
Great. And I know one of the things we talked about, we didn't get into enough detail in the last show, is so if a student has an IEP in high school or a 504 plan in high school, mm-hmm. how does that or does that carry over in the college?
It actually does not carry over.
Right.
So they do have protection with the Section 504 in the IDEA plan. So if they have a disability, they do have reasonable accommodations that they can request with that Section 504 that entitles them to support. But they do not have the level of support with an IEP. And just because they have an IEP or a 504 plan in high school does not translate to the college level, the post-secondary level. They need to seek out those people in the college and identify their disability again.
Right. Use that word request.
Mm-hmm.
And so the college is, it's going to be the students and the family's responsibility.
Correct. And it's really going to fall heavily on the student if they have the ability to do so.
Right.
So they have to actually meet the college's eligibility criteria. And there's a couple of ways that they can do that. And as long as the school receives federal funding, they do have to meet Section 504. But it cannot hurt the school financially, or they cannot be changing programming. So if the student is going for a certain program, they can't change the dynamics or the requirements of the program, but they can provide some accommodations. So the accommodations that are very familiar within the school settings, the college post-secondary schools, is reducing the course load. Substituting a course for another. So if there's two levels of the same course, they can substitute one course. Providing note takers or recording devices or sign language interpreters.
Yes, I ran into this situation where I was working with a student and they had to have someone go to class with them and take notes for them. And this
was
a legitimate accommodation where the student was an excellent student, but this is just one accommodation they needed to be successful.
For sure, absolutely. They can extend time for test taking. Mm-hmm. They can offer priority registration of courses so that they're not competing with other students for that same course. They can equip with school computers with screen reading or voice recognition or other adaptive software. Or they can provide the TTY in a dorm room for telephones for hearing impaired students, things of that nature. But the schools are not required to offer a paraprofessional or a one-on-one aide or a tutor or anything like that. So if it's a requirement to have one-on-one support, the student really needs to find that support themselves.
That's interesting, because we always talk about the student. One of the first thing the student should do when they get on campus is find that tutoring center, because their parents are paying for it.
Yeah,
in tuition,
absolutely.
Find the health center. Mm-hmm. You brought up one point about students or colleges that are receiving federal aid have to follow this, these requirements. Not all colleges receive federal aid. There's some small private colleges that don't. Grove City is one of them.
Right.
They don't receive federal aid, so they do not have to follow these guidelines. So this is one thing to investigate.
And that doesn't mean that the school isn't going to follow through with it. It just means they're not required to follow through with it. So it's a very good question to ask when you're going to visit colleges, for sure. And so I guess the name of the game is self-advocacy. Most of these students have had a group of people supporting them throughout elementary school, middle school, and high school. They have a team. They have their parents and things like that. And a lot of times when they go off to school, they're finding they're on their own. So there are some people that they can connect with right away when they go to the school. One is called a disability support coordinator or a 504 coordinator, an ADA coordinator. So each school kind of calls it something different, but most schools have that person in place that they need to connect with that will help them move through the requirements and things like that. really, really important is to do this at the very beginning of the semester.
Exactly.
Don't wait till you're struggling to then say, well, hey, I have a diagnosis and I need support.
Right.
It's really important to get these things in place right off the beginning of the term so you're not trying to play catch up and things like that.
And families should realize the colleges are expecting this. They're set up. Mm-hmm. They have the departments and the personnel ready to go to help students. And this self-advocacy, this is with every student. A lot of times high school kids struggle with this, and we're not talking just students who need extra support. We're talking kids who want to be involved in extracurriculars and athletics, but you really do have to self-advocate.
Mm-hmm, absolutely, and that's a skill. I mean, they need
no doubt
to learn it.
Yes.
And I think high schools do a really good job of starting to ask the kids to be more independent and to be monitoring their grades and being on top of things. Unfortunately, a lot of times they don't teach them how to do that. They're just expected to be conveying the information to their parents and things like that. So that's something I hear from a lot of my families in high school is the teachers don't talk to me anymore. They talk to my kid. And
yes,
they don't always convey the information.
But
it is a really good opportunity for the kids to start doing the self-advocacy.
Talking to the student and make them the major part of the process and give them responsibility.
Absolutely.
The parents may be accountable, but the student's responsible.
Mm-hmm, for sure. And it really is starting to step them into that ability. The IEP or the 504 doesn't, like I said, mean that they're going to get support in the school. So there are a couple different things that they do need to do. They need to have an evaluation by a psychologist or a medical doctor that they take to the school. They need to talk with the school about what the requirements are. So there's a couple different things that they need to look at, you know, the diagnosis of the current disability, the date of the diagnosis, how it was reached, credentials of the professionals that are doing that, and how the disability affects a major life activity. So these are things that the school is a lot of times looking for that the student needs to find. And they can find vocational rehabilitation agencies that will help them go through this process too. So there are organizations and people out there that are gonna help them do this. It's not just on their own, but it's really good to talk about that as they're looking into the colleges and things like that. So they have those people in place that they already know who's gonna be helping them with their self-advocacy.
That's awesome, that's great. I'm sure that's very comforting for some parents with middle school or high school students and thinking,
absolutely,
you know, what's gonna happen? Is the support available? And a lot of times it is available.
You just have to ask.
You just have to ask.
Absolutely.
So that takes care of the segment with Heather. Heather Campbell from Club Z Tutoring. Thanks, Heather. We talked about IEPs. It's wonderful. Join us in our next segment. We're going to run through the processes parents should be following or can follow with their kids to get them set to go through that college application process. We'll be right back.
Behind the wheel, there is no such thing as a small distraction. A public service reminder from the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons. Speak out against distracted driving at decidetodrive.org.
And now, another adventure with Savings Man.
Look, honey, it's my Social Security statement.
Oh, gosh, how are we going to retire on that?
Never fear, young savers.
It's Savings Man.
You need to save more. You'll need this.
Oh, the ballpark estimate worksheet.
That's right. Get it at choosetosave.org and find out how much you'll need to save for your future.
Gee, thanks, Savings Man.
No, thank you.
So visit choosetosave.org and stay tuned for more Savings Man.
Hi, welcome back. I'm Chris Hitchens, your college application coach, member of Bethel Park Chamber of Commerce. In this next segment, we're going to talk about the processes parents can follow to help their kid with their college planning. Now, sometimes you want to get outside help. Sometimes you need advice. But if you're stuck on what to do, we're going to run through the steps. And then in upcoming shows, we're going to go into each step in detail. So here are the steps, and we get through them all in one segment. And the first step is have the talk with the student. What's the talk? The talk is the money talk. 20 years ago, 30 years ago, it may not matter that much. We need to talk about how much the family is willing to contribute each year towards the college application of the student. And you have to keep in mind whether there's siblings involved. So how much will the family contribute? Is it $5,000 a year you're going to help out? Is it $10,000? Is it $50,000? If it's zero, they need to know. Because this is going to determine which colleges we're going to target. Now, next, you're going to figure out your EFC. What's that? Your expected financial contribution from the government. Now, this is where the FAFSA comes in. Now, your student may not be a senior. That's okay. We're going to do a practice FAFSA. This is going to determine how much the government thinks you can contribute each year to your child's college education. Again, this is just a step in the process. So if you go to FAFSA Forecaster, it's easy to Google, practice FAFSA, FAFSA Forecaster, put in your numbers, it'll give you an idea. Does the government think that you have $20,000 sitting around in the sock drawer you can give to your kid each year for the college application? Do they think, well, you don't make that much money? We don't expect you to contribute anything. You should at least know this number. Next, we're going to go to the colleges we're interested in. You don't have to do this all right now, but you should do a couple. And go to what's called their net price calculator. We'll get into details later on about what's a good net price calculator, what's a poor net price calculator. This will give you an idea of what the college would expect your family to pay in tuition, room and board, their cost of attendance for 1 year. So you go to Pitt's net price calculator, Penn State, Slippery Rock, find their net price calculator. And then we're going to look at your EFC, your expected family contribution, your cost of attendance, and we're going to figure out what kind of need you're hopefully going to get through scholarships or work programs or just contributions or loans. You want to go on college visits, and we're going to talk about what you should look at when you visit colleges. Visiting colleges is a process you should probably start early on. I mean, honestly, freshman year in high school, sophomore year in high school, that is not too early. Kids change, and it's nice. They'll look at something as a freshman or sophomore, and as they evolve and develop, they may have different ideas of what kind of college they want to go to, but it's nice to get those first impressions there and kind of set up those comparisons. It'll make things easier in the long run. So just walking onto a college and visiting, whether it's an official visit or unofficial visit, is very easy. So you want to research colleges. We're going to give you some tools to research college. One of the best tools to research colleges is called the common data set. And each college has a common data set on their website. And the common data set will tell you what the attributes are of the students who go to that college. The common data set on each college's website, sometimes it's buried and hidden. We'll talk about where and why and how later on. It will tell you the average SAT score of all the freshmen coming in to that college, the average SAT, average grade point average of the students at that college. It will tell you what the college values. Does it value grade point average? Does it value SAT scores? Does it value extracurricular? Does it value a college essay? Does it value community service? And you'd be surprised. Some colleges value different things. Denison's one college, wonderful college in Ohio, private college, people love. SAT scores and grade point average aren't necessarily the most important attribute students have to display. But it's a fantastic college. Kids come out and are very successful. So we're going to look at that common data set. The SAT itself. All right. SAT prep works. And a lot of times SAT translates directly to money. So an SAT prep works. This is SAT season. Now we're going to talk about SATs in detail, but really, students should take the SAT three times. SAT is like training for a marathon, and the better they get at taking the SAT, the higher their scores are going to be. Like I said, SAT scores can contribute greatly to the amount of aid students or colleges are willing to give the student. And SAT tutoring, SAT prep works. There's paid tutoring, there's free tutoring. We'll talk about those in upcoming shows. So where do you find these colleges? I recommend you look beyond the list. What's that mean? Well, growing up in Western Pennsylvania, it's a big advantage. We have so many schools, a lot of state schools, wonderful small private schools. So we have Pitt, Penn State, CMU, we have Slippery Rock, IUP, we have West Virginia close by, all these wonderful schools. If your kid wants to go there, fantastic. I recommend that the family looks beyond these schools. There are gems, dozens of them. Private schools, small schools, and these are the schools that have money. The kids may love. It's possible to go to these colleges that you see. They looks like their net price is going to be $60,000, $70,000. It's possible to go to college at these colleges for the same price that you'd pay at Slippery Rock or Pitt or Penn State. We have to find these colleges. Now, there's no tricks or strategies or bribing going on, but finding that college where your student matches up is the key to keeping them happy. Keeping them happy will make them successful. Making them successful will keep them, will help them thrive, and will save you a great deal of money. They'll come out with a four-year, in 4 years, with a career, and hopefully not move back into your basement. So the college essay. The college essay is not a high school English paper. So there's details about the college essay. I do a number of free college essay workshops. You can contact me. I'm doing one in Baldwin the end of May. Free college essay workshop for juniors. Talk about what a real college essay looks like and which colleges really pay a lot of credence to that college essay. So that's it for this segment of the college admissions coach, the college application coach. Again, I'm Chris Hitchens, member of Bethel Park Chamber of Commerce. We'll see you soon. Bye. Thanks.
I think film and television in general is a very discouraging industry. It takes a lot of years of pounding the pavement, calling people, finding your ends. You're gonna carry a lot of heavy cable, get dirty a lot, and find your way in. With the limited amount of resources out there and the limited amount of opportunities, there's a fantastic resource right here. And it's public access, it's free of charge. Anybody can come in and gain that experience. Dave absolutely loves to help people, you know, never said no to us growing up. Anything we wanted to do, we were able to do here. The first year I was here, I would just sign on for different projects, like Stump the Students was a show that I worked on quite frequently. It was a game show. We would just come up with our own little ideas, mostly sketches, a lot of school projects, a lot of classes when we'd have to do a project on a story we read or something like that. I would always ask if we could do a video as our project instead, and we would typically do it through Dave. You know, one of my favorite things we did was one of the simplest things we did. It was put together in an afternoon. It was something we wanted to do for fun. We were playing around learning Final Cut Pro, learning how to do linear editing, and we decided to do something in reverse. So we filmed me, actually, I think it was, running around the building out here, jumping off walls backwards, running around backwards, and played the whole thing in reverse. It was really simple. It was, you know, corny. We just did it for fun, but for a couple weeks after that, people kept coming up to me at school like, well, how'd you do that? We were more exposed to our student body than we felt we were, not having an association with any extracurriculars of the school. It was fun to see how, even though we were doing it on our own, it was still making its reach to Bethel Park, and it was still something that we were getting feedback for, positive feedback from, and that was really nice. I would say that BPTV is one of the greatest creative resources this community has, and I would absolutely encourage anyone with any interest in production to come here and learn from Dave and take their ideas and turn them into something. If I hadn't been here at BPTV, I wouldn't have advanced at the rate I did in my industry. I wouldn't have had the passion for my industry nurtured the way it was here. I don't think that I would have pursued it because I don't think I would have had as clear a picture of what was available to me in this industry unless I had come here and gotten that firsthand experience prior to having to make the decisions that you have to make whenever you're graduating from high school. Opportunity really only comes to people who establish a lifestyle to seize it. And this is the kind of place where you can seize an opportunity and change what you want your future to be.